can trust in my Lord. I see all the flaws, you see perfection, perfection. I learn slowly, but you're teaching me to love myself, myself. Starting to believe you want me like nobody is. I never measure up, but you are my enough. And sometimes I fail, and sometimes I can't do it well. But if they walk away, you don't walk away. You tell me I'm worth it still. Cause when all I see are the flaws, you see perfection, perfection. Looking through this mess of a heart, you see perfection, perfection. Show me what's behind your eyes. Don't think I can trust in my renown. I see all the flaws, you see perfection, perfection. Perfection. Looking through this mess of a heart, you see perfection, perfection. Show me what's behind your eyes. I don't think I can trust in mine alone. I see all the flaws, you see perfection, perfection.
Good morning and welcome to St Mary's. We're really glad that you've joined us for this service, wherever that might be from. Now, if this is your first time with us, an especially warm welcome to you. And if you're a regular, oh, we're so pleased that you're back with us again. This morning, we've reached the final message in our series for the autumn called Putting It All Together Again. And today we're looking at the question of just how bad is sin and what can we do about it? These last 18 months or so have been challenging in so many different ways. And whether you're a person of faith or no faith, it can feel as though life has been falling apart and you're now trying to get it back together again, a bit like pieces in a jigsaw puzzle. I hope this message is for you. The good news is that we needn't feel overwhelmed. We needn't feel alone. God promises to be there with us in the midst of all that is going on and whatever it is that we're facing. So our time together is going to include some singing, that's some worship, some practical teaching from the Bible, and an opportunity for reflection. My prayer is that you're going to discover more of who God really is, and you'll be encouraged in your faith in whatever situation you find yourself in. So shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we simply ask that by the power of your Spirit, as we open up the Bible and look into it, may you speak to us. Father, might we understand more fully your purpose, your plan, your calling for our life. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus bled and died for me. I just roar for Christ the King.
Welcome to the final message in our series, Putting It All Together Again. In it, we've been looking at the book of Ezra in the Bible because it offers wisdom and guidance for how it's possible to come back after a trauma. Now, that's a subject that seemed relevant to many people given the times that we find ourselves living in at the moment. Today, as we come to the end of the book, we discover what might appear on the surface as an unsatisfactory ending, given all the exploits and the success of God's people, such as the rebuilding of the temple. But if we're willing to dig deep, I want to suggest that what we find here is deeply significant, and if we understand it, it has the potential to change your life for good. Why? Because we're looking at how transformation can happen in your life through what the Bible refers to as repentance. Now, what's that? Whatever it is, it begins with recognizing the seriousness of sin and then turning away from it. The Bible treats sin really seriously. So perhaps one of the most sobering passages in the Bible is found in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, which says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Conveyed in this verse is the Christian understanding that sin affects your eternal destiny. Now, these are big issues. The Bible makes big claims. Perhaps you haven't really given much thought to this thing that the Bible refers to as sin. In fact, the Western world has largely reappropriated its meaning, changed it so that when the word is used today, it takes on almost the opposite of its original meaning. The world glamorizes and glorifies sin. It makes light of sin. It even markets sin as something that is good. So what's so important about sin, and how does this fit into the book of Ezra? To begin, I would like to read the opening verses from Ezra chapter 9 to set the scene. But because Ezra 9 and 10 is a long passage that on the surface deals with a specific contextual issue for God's people in Ezra's time, that was intermarriage, I'm intentionally going to go and focus on the wider issue of what the Bible says about sin and answer three main questions. What is the problem of sin? Is there any help for our condition? What do we need to do? So let's pick up again in the book of Ezra and read from chapter 9, verses 1 through to the start of verse 6. And it reads, "After these things had been done, the leaders came to me, as Ezra, and said, 'The people of Israel, including the priests and the Levites, have not kept themselves separate from the neighboring peoples with their detestable practices, like those of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, the Ammonites, the Moabites, the Egyptians, and Amorites. They have taken some of their daughters as wives for themselves and their sons, and have mingled the holy race with the peoples around them, and the leaders and officials have led the way in this unfaithfulness. When I heard this, I tore my tunic and cloak, pulled hair from my head and beard, and sat down appalled. Then everyone who trembled at the words of the God of Israel gathered round me because of this unfaithfulness of the exiles, and I sat there appalled until the evening sacrifice. Then, at the evening sacrifice, I rose from my self-abasement with my tunic and cloak torn and fell on my knees with my hands spread out to the Lord my God and prayed. Now, I'm going to pick up on some of the other verses in these two chapters later through the talk. So let's begin by returning to the words of the Apostle Paul's New Testament letter to the Romans to understand what the Bible says about the problem of sin. Recall the verse which referred to the wages of sin is death. The death Paul is describing is not physical death, although of course we know that the only certainty while here on earth is that one day we're going to die physically. No, what Paul is referring to here is spiritual death, which is an altogether more serious condition. The result of our sin is that we die spiritually, yet the world increasingly just laughs about sin. Ultimately, sin refers to our separation from God, and to help us understand the problem of sin and for us to get our heads around it and the seriousness of sin in the Bible, I would like to refer to four images for which I'm indebted to Nikki Gumbel and the Alpha Course. But just in case you think this is all a bit of an academic exercise relevant only to some people, a few verses earlier in the letter to the Romans, Paul says, chapter 3, verse 23, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." At its most basic understanding then, sin is missing or falling short of God's standard. You might think of an analogy of an arrow missing its target. Who has sinned? The Bible says all have sinned. That's every human being ever born. That includes you and me. So here's then the first problem of sin. It is the pollution of sin. Environmental pollution is now readily recognised to be a serious problem, but Jesus said it's also possible that sin pollutes our own lives. In Mark's Gospel, chapter 7, verse 20 to 23, Jesus says this, "What comes out of a person is what defiles them. In other words, what is deep within us is what makes us unclean." He went on, "For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and defile a person." It's these things that mess up our lives. Now, as we read through the list, you might have said, "Well, I don't do all of those things, so surely then I'm all right." It's a bit like in the law of the country. It's no good saying to a police officer, if you're had up for an offence, "Well, I haven't broken any of the other laws." That's why elsewhere in the New Testament, the Apostle James says this, "Whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it." The second problem is the power of sin. We all know about the increasing problem of addiction in the UK. In fact, recently the UK was labelled as the addiction capital of Europe. And we know of the damaging and destructive effects of some addictions. But it's not just the obvious chemical addictions that we need to talk about. We can become addicted to a bad temper, or to envy, or pride, or selfishness, or lust. In fact, just about anything. Any of these things, these sins, can get a grip of our lives. Here then is the parallel to sin. Jesus says anyone who sins is a slave of sin. It gets a grip on us. Third problem, it's the penalty of sin. Often something within us cries out for justice when we see something that's wrong. For example, when we see in, say, the news a story of a child being abused or an old person being attacked in their home, something within us cries out, "That's wrong. The people who did that should be caught and brought to justice. There should be a penalty for that." isn't it so much easier to say that about other people? Yes, they deserve it, but much harder to say of ourselves when we do something wrong. It's the hypocrite within us. We're happy to judge others, but not ourselves. Again, the Apostle Paul writes in Romans, he says, "You therefore have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else, for at whatever point you judge another, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same things." Fourth problem of sin is the partition of sin. Recall Romans 6 verse 23, in which we read, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." The wages of sin is death. Paul is not talking about physical death, he's talking about spiritual death, which comes from being cut off from God. The fact that there is a partition between us and God is because of the things that we do wrong. It's why the prophet Isaiah says, it's not that God can't hear you. He says, it's the fact that your iniquities, your sins, have caused a separation between you and your God. These things that we do wrong have the potential to cut us off from God eternally. I guess it's a bit like when you fall out with a good friend and it gets really awkward when you're with them and you can't look them in the eye. Sin separates us from God. This goes to explain why Ezra, when he heard of the people's sin, he tore his tunic and cloak, pulled hair from his head and beard and sat down appalled. Yet as we've already said, sin is something that people don't seem to blush about anymore. In fact, the reverse is often true. The world markets sin as good. The challenge for the Christian living in this sinful world is not to become habituated with sin, not to get used to it, even if we see it all around us. We are not to get accustomed to the bad smell, so to speak, of sin. Ezra is a reformer. That's why he's kind of unloading the scripture on them, because he knows reformation comes through repentance. He doesn't want God's people to get used to the smell of sin. Likewise, the challenge for every Christian now is this: God will only accept your worship if you take sin seriously. If you want biblical reformation, you must deal biblically with sin. Before I move on to the good news, and there is wonderful liberating news for the Christian about how to deal with sin, one final thought. Have you given much thought to the futility, it seems, of much of our politics today that often operates something like this? Society identifies a problem of some kind, an evil that needs to be addressed, and the response: create another law to try and protect society from the evil, while never really acknowledging or addressing the root cause behind it, our human sin. So we're done with the bad news. The good news of Christianity is that, and it is overwhelmingly good news, is that God loves you and me. And he doesn't just leave us there. He chose to do something about it. God so loved the world, that's you and me, that he sent his one and only son Jesus to do something about it. And the amazing thing is this: in no way did we deserve it. It was entirely an act of God's grace to us. So what was God's solution to the problem of sin? The solution is stunningly simple, and yet it's also a bit mysterious. It's basically this: God came to this earth in the person of his son Jesus Christ to die for you and for me. In the New Testament letter, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, we read, "He himself," that is Jesus, "bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed." The reference here is to Jesus' death on the cross, considered to be one of the most hideous ways invented by men and women to take another person's life. Yet, interestingly, the New Testament doesn't concentrate on the physical agony of Jesus on the cross, or even his emotional pain of being rejected by the world and deserted by his friends. What it concentrates on is, and this is unique to Jesus because others have suffered physically, was Jesus' spiritual suffering. Jesus was cut off from his heavenly Father God for us when he carried our sins. Again in the Bible, in Isaiah 53 verse 6 we read, "We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." Now, if you're struggling to understand Jesus dying on the cross, perhaps the following illustration might help. If you imagine on one hand represents you and me, your life and my life, and if I were to place a book or something on my hand, you could see that it becomes a barrier between us and God. Now, if I then take my other hand and I let that represent Jesus, Jesus never did anything wrong. He lived a sinless life. There was no barrier between him and his Father. And so what the verse says is this: we all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And then it says the Lord has laid on him and put this barrier, the sin of us, on Jesus. That's what happened on the cross. The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Jesus on the cross was carrying your sin and my sin, and therefore he was cut off from God, not because of what he'd done, but because of what we've done. And then I wonder if you see what happens. Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was cut off, as I say, not for his own sin, but for our sin. And you see where that then leaves us, where it leaves you and me. It leaves us free to have a relationship with God because there's no barrier between us. And what's even more remarkable is that God gave his son Jesus to die for all people, everywhere, for all time. Now, it doesn't matter how good or bad a person has been. God's grace extends to everyone who calls on God's name through putting their trust and faith in his son, Jesus Christ. So let's bring all of this back to Ezra, and I want to talk about where reformation comes through repentance. Because in here we have an example of how we're to live our life in the light of the glorious forgiveness of our sin. There is an obvious question people ask when they realise their sin is forgiven, and it's this: is it all right then if I just continue to sin, perhaps even sin more, so that I might experience even more of God's grace? The answer is emphatically no. The new life of the Christian and the life the Christian experiences in Christ means that they have died to sin. And so if you have died to sin, you can't go on living in it. We are to hate sin in our life because God hates sin. So although we have freely received God's forgiveness through Jesus' death on the cross, we are to live a life of repentance so that we might be truly reformed and renewed. That's exactly what we see in Ezra chapter 10. We see the people taking the sin of intermarrying very seriously when it was brought to light through the faithful preaching of God's word. And they choose to deal with this sin and repent at all costs. The process of finding out precisely the nature and the scope of their sin was taken very seriously. It lasted several months. We read that the people even stood out in the cold and rain. They were taking the matter of sin very seriously. In their specific historical context, as God's chosen holy people, the issue of intermarrying, men marrying foreign women, was very serious, and the call for those who had disobeyed God in this matter was to separate. Now, the passage doesn't tell us how this happened, just that they set about sorting the matter out. The issue here for God's people was that it was affecting their covenant relationship with God. God had forbidden this practice because, as we have recorded in Deuteronomy chapter 7, intermarrying would turn them and their children away from God, leading the people into the serious sins of unfaithfulness and idolatry. So we need to understand the historical context before we clumsily translate this passage into contemporary practice for Christians today. The matter at heart for us here in Israel is in Ezra, is that the people recognize their sinful behavior and their disobedience to God and are convicted then to repent because they know that reformation comes through true repentance. It is a humbling lesson for us too when we recognize sin in our life. But then do we just put up with the sin and live with it and all the serious implications for our relationship with God? Or will we deal with it and make sorting it out the highest priority in our life, repentance at all costs? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you that in the gospel we have a glorious good news story that means that our sin can be forgiven, that we can be put back in right relationship with you, that there is no barrier between us and you, God. But Father, I pray that we might be those who do take sin seriously, that Father, when we recognize that there is stuff in our life that is wrong, that we might not just put up with it, but we might act and do whatever we can in your strength of your spirit to drive out and get rid of the sin in our life. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We really hope that you found your time with us encouraging, and we look forward to being able to welcome you back again. Now, if you'd like to find out more about St Mary's, please join us for other services, and if you haven't done so already, we'd love it if you'd subscribe to our YouTube channel. Now, I'm conscious we've discussed a lot of things today, and if you have any questions, I'd encourage you to keep exploring them, and if there's any way we can help, please do get in contact. And if you're local to Purley, do come and join us in person on a Sunday morning. Specifically, if you'd like to explore the claims of the Christian faith in more detail, Alpha is a great place to do so. And if you'd like to join our next course or have any questions about it, please just get in contact with us. And if you're interested in meeting with other Christians in a small group and growing in your faith, Connect Groups offer a great opportunity for doing this. Again, please just get in contact with us. But now, I'd like to close with a blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.